是的，中国，的中国，baby，When we make it, it'll be amazing. Let's stay at it. It's on God, that's on, that's on, that's on, that's on God, that's on, that's on, that's on God, that's on. Hey, how y'all doing today? Who won? No one on yet? That's on God, that's on, that's on, that's on, that's on, baby.When we back there, it'll be amazing. Let's stay at it. It's on God. That's on. That's 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 on, baby. When we make it, it'll be amazing. Let's keep at it.Put it on God. That's on God. Hey, hey. When we make it, if you make it, let's stay at it. Cause it's on God. Put it on God.Putting it on God, baby. Putting it on God. Baby, when we make it, it'll be amazing. Let's stay at it. That's on, that's on, that's on God, that's on, that's on God, that's on, that's on God, that's on, baby.When we make it, it'll be amazing. Let's stay at it, cause that's on God. That's on God, that's on, that's on God. That's on God, that's on, baby. When we make it, it'll be amazing. Let's stay at it, it's on God. Peace, good world. Goody, goody, goody world.I just went to my YouTube link in bio, right? I just had to go and, yeah, going through that right now. That's the move. That's on God.That's on God. That's on God. Baby, when we make it, it'll be amazing. Let's keep at it. That's on God. Yeah. That's on God. That's on. That's on. Man, I can't wait. I don't know what I'm waiting on. Oh, man.It's the COVID body, y'all. Lord of mercy. Oh, COVID. No excuses, though. No excuses. Just reasons. A few reasons. A couple reasons for the season. Lord of mercy. COVID body. I really should go in the shower, but I got something on my mind. I would like to share with you beautiful people out there.All 10 of y'all. Peace, peace, peace. You know what? I got a whole bunch of songs I need to record. See, I won dread. Still feel good. You know what I'm saying? That one dread.Yeah, got a whole bunch of microphones to blast. That's on, 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 That's on. Do you? That's on. When we make it, it'll be amazing. Let's get at it. That's on God. Hallelujah. That's on God. Yeah. That's on God. 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 Baby, make it, baby. Baby, when we make it, it'll be amazing. Let's stay at it. It's on God. Alright. You know, a few of these things that are essential to success. If you're anything like me in this world, you will understand. You know, if you don't understand, you're going against yourself. Self-destruction is a powerful thing, though. Let's keep that in mind as we have to lead culture through samsara. Excuse me, y'all. Cosmic King, Coach King, carried the loose, however, you know me. Athlete culture, body, mind, engineering. Body, mind, engineering. Still at it. Conjuring. You know, it's a magical life. It's a beautiful life. So, one of my favorite movies in the world. Alright, one of my favorite movies in the world is The Matrix and the other ones that follow. I think it was about a year, maybe 2 years ago, I caught wind of a Matrix 4. Uno, dos, tres, cuatros. Now, I've never seen the Animatrix. I didn't actually know that something called the Animatrix existed until yesterday. When the Matrix movie caught my mind, right? I didn't even know Animatrix existed. I didn't even know they had a comic book, you know? Now, I'll tell you this. If anybody's got the script, the original Matrix script, nah, that's a whole bunch of reading. I'm good, never mind. But it's one of the most interesting cinematic stories that I've ever, you know, seen and watched and enjoyed and pondered upon and, you know, just that entered my being, right? And kind of broadened my understanding of tech and you know, just, I mean, come on, if you're a fan of The Matrix, what didn't it do for your mind? Really, though, if you're a fan of The Matrix, what didn't it do for your mind, right? So, I got real excited when I heard that a fourth installment was going to happen. And I'm like, man. And you know how Hollywood gets sometimes. I'm like, yo, Lawrence Fishburne better be in it, right? Original Morpheus better be more, because Morpheus didn't die in the last movie. Neo got carried away. A truce was made, right? And I know human beings, right? So I'm like, yo, I know human beings, right? Ain't no human being is gonna be relegated to some hole in the wall while there's a big old earth going on, right? No matter how ugly and messed up and, you know, clouded with no sunshine, no matter what it looks like, ain't no human being is just gonna be up in some hole, you know, and good with it. So I know they down there in Zion, you know, whipping it up, right? I know they down there in Zion cooking something up, okay? I mean, it's just logical human being things that we do. Plus, well, not plus, because I was about to say, you know, the machines wouldn't leave them alone, but apparently they kind of do leave them alone. Partly due to the defense system that Zion has, right? And of course, the machines are kind of toying with their prey in a sense, or I don't know. Yeah, you holler at me on that. Why would the machines leave Zion alone if they could just... Especially if Neo is out of the picture. Now, the whole thing about Neo, what makes Neo special, right, is not only has Neo mastered the Matrix, Neo has, you know, has all capabilities and possibilities and probabilities, actualities of doing whatever he does in the Matrix, right? Not only can he do that, right? Also, out in the real world, we saw Neo drop a whole bunch of machines. Like a living EMP, right? So, if you're the machines, you're like, man, how many more of them they got? But they probably not thinking that. They probably know that it's just this one. I mean, there's the whole Christ story as well. Okay, there's the whole Christ story in there as well that some people will get turned off to. But there's no doubt that this movie is one, because I'm into tech and all that. Like, I'm not into tech to where I'm like, you know, I gotta have the latest tech. But you know, like ever since I was what, 9, 10 years old, I first saw Terminator. It was like, and that was it. Ever since I saw that first, no, it was Terminator 2 was the first Terminator movie I saw. When I saw Terminator 2. And I saw T-1000, I was like, you know what I'm saying? I was drooling over that movie. So, anything that kind of relates to those kinds of realities, I'm usually all over. Like, what's going on there? Age of Ultron, I gotta watch that again. Age of Ultron. Yeah, there's plenty of them out there, right? I know this might seem like a far reach away from the rapper baller lifestyle, but, you know, it is the rapper baller lifestyle. Ain't too much away from it. Like, people probably never think about all the tech that involves that's in sports. There's a whole bunch of tech in sports, you know? And rap, like, come on. Like, ain't nobody on the corner no more. You know what I'm saying? In a cypher of 20 people getting changed in a bucket with no microphone and no monitor, no, you know what I'm saying? No speaker box and whatnot. Like, ain't nobody out there doing that. And even then, the microphone and the speaker box is tech, it's technology, right? So, I've always been fascinated with radio, cell phones, and whatnot. I really want a mechanical engineering degree, to be honest with you. One of these days, I am going to be a mechanical engineer, and I am going to talk like this, just because it is how all mechanical engineers and scientists should talk. And I can do it. So why not? When I am a mechanical engineer, you will not know me. Do not act like you know me. I will spray you with COVID or some shit. But, nah, really though. Yeah, I've always been interested in mechanical. It's like that thing. It's like that thing that I'm missing in this lifetime. You know, like my brain will get to a certain point and then, and then it's like, go play some basketball. And I'm good with it, whatever, you know? Like, Maybe it's not meant to be for me to have those kinds of, that kind of knowledge and expertise and know-how. So, you know, I'm good with it. I'm good just, you know what I'm saying? With my little baby. Where my baby at? Come here, baby girl. Come here. Bring you out to the world. I have my little baby away from me for a minute. Bring you back to the world, baby. So, if you know, yeah, it's quite a reach, but I'm such a fan. And last night I was on the topic, man. I'm like, wow, because Mortal Kombat just came out. I've yet to see it. You know, Mortal Kombat just came out. I haven't seen it yet. I gotta see that. But then I was like, you know what? When is Matrix 4 coming out? And what is the storyline gonna be? I'm on YouTube, and everybody's wondering the same thing. Okay? And I mean everybody in the world is wondering, when is Matrix 4 coming out? Alright? But first, let's see. There's some things about that movie that was revealed to me. Not revealed to me, but I never ever thought about. Alright, and I'm gonna show you one. Let me know if you ever, it's just one of those things like that left my mind. And she was so sneaky. So sneaky, right? The girl who escaped the Oracle. Right, she was so sneaky, right? Okay, see, I haven't seen this one. This one is why the architect and the Oracle are at war. I haven't seen this one yet, right? Right.
So we match all the cash back you earned at the end of the first year.
So the Oracle, right? Now I'm thinking Oracle. The whole time, right, I'm thinking the Oracle's on their side. It's like a human, right? But last night I realized she wasn't in Zion. So if she wasn't in Zion, that means she's plugged in or she's a machine program. Right? If she's not unplugged and she's not still plugged in, then that means she's a machine program, right? And with the amount of knowledge, omniscient and future knowledge that she has, then she's kind of like at God level in the Matrix, like the architect. Let's check this out.
Two complex characters, stories, and symbolisms are just begging to be analyzed and studied. The creators of this intriguing universe, the Wachowskis, once affirmed that they were tired of watching simple films that answered all the questions by the end, not leaving room for the viewer to reach their own conclusions or opinions. This is why they created the Matrix with a level of depth that is still being discussed 2 decades after its premiere. Thanks to its complexity, there is still many unanswered questions. And that is precisely the reason why we created this channel, to analyze every little detail and theorize their meanings. One of the most important conflicts in the Matrix is the battle between the Oracle and the Architect. Are these programs competing for their self-interests, or are they working together towards a common goal? Looking back at everything that happened in these films, we could reach a conclusion as to what is the true purpose of these two programs. Is the Oracle a program that fights for humanity, or does she work in conjunction with the Architect?
Boom!
Welcome to Matrix Explained.
Now, once again, right? It's either the Oracle is so good at her job working for the construct that I missed it, or I don't know. I don't know how I would have missed that. Or she's really on the side of free flesh and bone, right? Which, and then it got me to think. Well, maybe. Maybe the flesh and bones, the humans, Zion, the Zionists, sounds weird saying that, the freeborns,
maybe the freeborns of the Matrix. I mean, they are hackers. They are computer literate and machine literate. So maybe they were able to hack in and create their own programs and slide in their own programming and whatnot. So, I mean, there's a couple ways that this could go with the Oracle, but she snuck by me. Like, I really, like what? Does she? You know, and then it hit me last night. Well, you know, all the things that she did and all the things that she knew was going to happen that happened and the choices and da-da-da. But then it's like, wait a minute. Is she with the Freeborns or is she like a check and balance of the Matrix system? Well, now, why does it matter? It matters a lot because she influenced a lot of what Neo did, right? So check this out, right? There's another video that after this we check it out, right? So that's the question: why the Architect and the Oracle are at war, and is she with the Freeborns or is she with the machines?
Are they real? Let us begin with a simple question. What did the Architect mean when he says to the Oracle,
"You played a very dangerous game"?
You're playing a very dangerous game.
As this line might be, it could be the key to the nature of the Oracle Architect rivalry. We've theorized that the
now this man look like KFC man, like he making chicken right now up in heaven or something. He makes the chicken. I like chicken, so I'm trapped. You know, I just might be Cypher and come back to the Matrix for the chicken. Can I get some chicken? Just want some chicken, man. But look at this man. He looks like the Colonel.
Oracle does work for or with the Architect. She is the one who guided Neo to the Source without warning him about the Architect, the Anomaly, or his predecessors. She built up the relationship between Neo and Trinity. She did not warn Morpheus about Cypher's plans, etc.
Right,
there
she saw that coming.
There are reasons why we can't
exactly
deduce
like
that the Oracle
how she didn't know that was coming.
And
come
it
on.
It wasn't the well-being of humanity. Every choice that Neo made led him towards the Architect. The same choices that the Oracle influenced. Without a doubt, we see both the Oracle and the Architect working towards the same goal. But to what end? Well, the Matrix simulation had achieved 99% effectiveness thanks to the implementation of choice.
If I am the father of the Matrix, she would undoubtedly be its mother.
She would undoubtedly be the mother.
Please. As I was saying, she stumbled upon a solution whereby nearly 99% of all test subjects accepted the program as long as they were given a choice, even if they were only aware of the choice at a near unconscious level.
So the answer should be obvious. The two programs are working together to reach 100% effectiveness. The Architect's job is to balance the equation logically, and the Oracle's job is to unbalance it.
The Architect told me that if I didn't return to the Source, Zion would be destroyed by midnight tonight.
Please. You and I may not be able to see beyond our own choices, but that man can't see past any choice.
Why not?
He doesn't understand them. He can't. To him, they are variables in an equation. One at a time, each variable must be solved and counted. That's his purpose.
Oh.
To balance the equation.
What's your purpose?
Ooh, okay, so... okay, see, that's a big point right there. She just said that the... she just said that the Architect cannot reason. Math, you know, programs are built through precision, mathematical equation and precision. But the human psyche and the human, it's like I was talking to someone the other day. It's like, yo, Is it love or logic for you? I'm like, love all day, because love is an emotional connection. There's something deeper, right? It's not just 1 + 1 = 2 with love. It's 1 + emotions and feelings and what you do for me and what I do for you, plus 1 + you know what I'm saying, = 2 + you know. So where they could try and calculate everything that they want to create this facade, this thing, the matrix, right? They can't quite get it down to a science, because the human being is not a mathematical equation. It's not, the human being's body is not mathematics, right? The human being is not enough mathematics to where a robot can guess its every, you know, I don't know, intention, to guess its every action, to guess its every reaction. So the architect doesn't really understand human beings as well as the oracle does.
Right.
The time each variable must be solved and counted.
Each variable must be solved and counted. But the human being does not work like a variable. So many cells and so many parts within that cell, and so many outside influences imposing itself upon those cells, and da 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 da.
Please, you and I may not be able to see beyond our own choices, but that man can't see past any choice.
Why not?
He doesn't understand them. He can't. To him, they are variables in an equation. One at a time, each variable must be solved and counted. That's his purpose, to balance the equation.
What's your purpose?
To unbalance it.
So while he can react, basically what she's saying is, while he can react, she can foresee, right? So he's reacting to, and in a sense, they're still, the machines aren't as free as they think they are. Of course not. You know, they still gotta harbor human beings for energy, right? So they're still not as free as they think that they are, simply because they can't. The architect has to react, right? So every time something, because they said it was like the fifth matrix or something like that, right? So every time the humans, the freeborns and the humans break out of the matrix, and let's say it gets destroyed, there's only so much calculations they can make a new one, to where humanity is not totally imprisoned, right? And she seems to be the, while the architect's the calculator, she's more so more of the human that's got the book, right? And is going through the book in a sense, or can go ahead and look in the back of the book in the glossary for, I'm saying, for the answer or things that, like, she could piece things together better than he can. So while he wants to have a complete construct that chains and binds the beings, humans and whatnot, Well, here we go. I'm trying to find out her role. Like, what is it? Because I know he wants to have a complete construct to where Neo's and awakenings don't happen, right? And she, I don't know. I don't know her role. I don't know her role.
Now, what does the Oracle mean about unbalancing? Do you know what a generative adversarial network is?
No,
the website, thispersondoesnotexist.com, is a page that was created as a result of the action of two artificial intelligence competing against each other. One AI creates pictures of human faces, and a second AI is in charge of detecting which photos are created by computer and which are real. The computer-generated photos that look fake are deleted. These two programs learn from each other. The first artificial intelligence became an expert in drawing human faces, while the second artificial intelligence, in turn, became an expert in detecting fake photographs. The result of this experiment were photographs that looked real, like if they were taken by real people, but they were actually computer-generated drawings. The existence of these two competing AI programs had achieved near perfection in creating human portraits. This is known as a generative adversarial network. It is a type of machine learning where two neural networks compete against each other in a zero-sum game, where one's game is the other's.
Gunshot! Blinky, 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 blow! Okay.
So the answer should be obvious. The two programs are working together to reach 100% effectiveness. The architect's job is to balance the equation logically, and the Oracle's job is to unbalance it.
The architect told me that if I didn't return to the source, Zion would be destroyed by midnight tonight.
Please. You and I may not be able to see beyond our own choices, but that man can't see past any choice.
Why not?
He doesn't understand them. He can't. To him, they are variables in an equation.
So, okay, in a sense, what she just said, in a sense, is that the architect expected human beings to accept the matrix, the sleeper cell, the virtual reality state, you know, it's not a trans, but yeah, you know, the sleeper cell and what's that movie? The surrogate state, right? They expected human beings to just accept the surrogate state. And that's why he can't understand why, you know, Morpheus's and Trinity's and Neo's happen, you know, and why people wake up and get unplugged, and why would they want to be in Zion when they can, you know, why would you want to be in Zion when you can, I'm saying, so, be it when you can be in the Matrix. So he doesn't seem to understand the choices that human beings make or get.
Time each variable must be solved and counted. That's his purpose, to balance the equation.
What's your purpose?
To unbalance it.
Now, what does the Oracle mean about unbalancing? Do you know what a generative adversarial network is?
What?
The website, thispersondoesnotexist.com, is a page that was created as a result of the action of two artificial intelligence competing against each other. One AI creates pictures of human faces, and a second AI is in charge of detecting which photos are created by computer and which are real. The computer-generated photos that look fake are deleted. These two programs learn from each other. The first artificial intelligence became an expert in drawing human faces, while the second artificial intelligence, in turn, became an expert in detecting fake photographs. The result of this experiment were photographs that looked real, like if they were taken by real people, but they were actually computer-generated drawings. The existence of these two competing AI programs had achieved near perfection in creating human portraits. This is known as a generative adversarial network. It is a type of machine learning where two neural networks compete against each other in a zero-sum game, where one's gain is the other's loss. This helps each AI to learn from their losses. Now, how does this apply to the Oracle and the Architect? The Architect's job is to find the balance in the equation, and the Oracle's job is to imbalance it. Here we have two adversarial AIs that are learning from each other. This is the function of the generative adversarial network. Saying that the Oracle and the Architect are enemies is absurd. Both are fundamental parts of the Matrix. They are the father and the mother in search of perfection.
Right.
So what did the Architect mean by saying that the Oracle was playing a dangerous game? Although these two are working together, the Oracle's actions evade the Architect's logical reasoning. As we've mentioned in previous videos, the Oracle allowed Smith to assimilate her, thereby putting at risk the Matrix and the real world. And this is what the Architect was referring to. The father could not understand the mother's logic or reason for allowing herself to be assimilated by Smith, taking such a dangerous gamble to try to implement change in the equation.
You played a very dangerous game.
Change always is.
The word game is the definition of the generative adversarial network. The Oracle is a stress program. It was created to test the new version of the Matrix, manipulating everything in its favor, searching for flaws, and competing with the Architect, perpetuating the emergence of the integral anomaly, returning it to the source, restarting the simulation, and repeating the cycle. The Oracle will again search for issues in the new version of the simulation, and the Architect will create a new version with improvements. Though this cycle has been broken in Matrix Revolutions, the Oracle said that change always is, as in dangerous, regardless of her efforts. Adversarial network. The Oracle is a stress program. It was created to test the new version of the Matrix, manipulating everything in its favor, searching for flaws, and competing with the Architect, perpetuating the emergence of the integral anomaly, returning it to the source, restarting the simulation, and repeating the cycle. The Oracle will again search for issues in the new version of the simulation, and the Architect will create a new version with improvements. Though this cycle has been broken in Matrix Revolutions, the Oracle said that change always is, as in dangerous. Regardless of her efforts, the peace she helped establish was not going to last. The Oracle added something new to the equation, peace. She helped the Architect by adding choice and love to the equation. And now with this third addition, the elusive 100% effectiveness is ever closer. This is the first time that the Matrix was not completely reset. It was updated. A patch was added to fix some of the errors in the operating system, but it wasn't a factory reset. The Oracle knows that the Architect is close to achieving his goal. This is why he agreed to the Oracle's request to let out anyone who wanted to leave the simulation. This cooperation is not only due to Neo's sacrifice, but also to the fact that the Oracle has managed to implement changes into the simulation, increasing its effectiveness. The Architect does recognize that she is improving the simulation. Although perfection of the simulation is the ultimate goal, it is unachievable because Neo is still alive. There are also exiled programs inside the new version of the Matrix. The existence of the Merovingian and his followers represents corruption in the simulation. After all, the Matrix was only patched. It is not a new version. So we may see the equation losing its balance once again in
Ayo!
I smell science.
What's this do?
This is mixed up.
No idea.
You can make your own mixed up one with Lunchables with 100% juice.
So how does a veterinarian become CEO of one of the biggest companies in the world?
It's unconventional.
Actually, yeah, I'll go watch this. I saw this like yesterday, so yeah, pretty good.
I spoke to Bob.
Explore, caused by a new system error that neither the of the Matrix. The existence of the Merovingian and his followers represents corruption in the simulation. After all, the Matrix was only patched. It is not a new version, so we may see the equation losing its balance once again in Matrix 4, caused by a new system error that neither the Oracle nor the Architect could have foreseen. But do you agree? What do you think is the true purpose of the Oracle and the Architect? Are they adversarial programs working together to improve the simulation?
I think, all right, new rationale. Based on the evidence that was just presented, I think the Oracle is one of the older programs, probably older than the Architect. While the Architect might have been the program that decided to overthrow humanity, the Oracle was probably the first programs, right, that humanity created to automate whatever the heck they were automating, right? So she was probably one of the, she's probably what we consider Siri or Alexa right now, right? She's probably Siri and Alexa, I'm saying. So yeah, she's probably Siri and Alexa, to where, you know, hey Siri, hey Alexa, hey Google, you know what I mean? So she's probably one of those first programs. And while the Architect is a later program. And why I'm saying this is because she might be the program that is more willing to serve humanity, right? And not, because if you think about it, right, they could go ahead and, right, just like he showed, just like Matrix Explained showed how the two artificial intelligence, the two computers were making pictures and all that, right, competing against one another, making pictures. Maybe that was the case with the Architect and the Oracle, to where the Oracle was still kind of benevolent and service to humanity, as in she probably had a button, you know, while the Architect is probably more data driven. You know what I mean? So once you gather enough data, then the Architect, as the Architect might be more data intelligence driven, the Oracle might be more kind of push button driven, to where it's not compiling its own data, it's not puzzling together data, where the Architect would be puzzling together data and coming up with its own conclusions and puzzling things together, to where she might know more of the Oracle might know more of the traits of human beings, you know, the little things, you could say. As they said, she helps him write love, you know, like these illogical connections that we sometimes have, that we usually do have, really. So yeah, she's probably one of the first programs that was written, kind of like what we have here today, Siri, Alexa, and those types of programs, to where they're reacting to human connection, right? And the Architect, might be more of a program that was written to compile data, to cipher through data, to put together data, to, to where it comes up with its own conclusions based on statistics and data, and not so much the interaction. So, that kind of answers my question, you know, is the Oracle more so with the humans and yeah, just as I thought. But I still to this day, like, well, till yesterday, I did not know that she was not I did know she didn't like have a body in Zion or something like that. But it never crossed my mind that she could be part of the system. That's what it is. Like, it never crossed my mind that she could be like an integral part of the system, you know? Because why would she need a protector if she was a part of the system? Seraph, right? Why would she need... I guess Seraph wasn't always... Was Seraph always there? Yeah, he was. Yeah. So why would she need a protector if she's a part of the system and a wanted part of the system? So I'm going to go to the conclusion that she's one of the older programs, one of the first that humanity created, such as what we have here today, Siri and Alexa and Google. Hello, Google, you know? So, where these things react to human interactions and whatnot, to where the architect is probably one of the newer programs that's responsible for self creation and self automation, which is a big deal because in the Terminators start creating their self. And just like you have in the Matrix, where you have a whole world of robots that have robots that have created their selves and have come to the conclusion. The data says, right, that they're the dominating force and the intelligent force, and that they need to be fed. You know what I mean? They do the eating instead of, you know? And the machine's logic, the architect's whole thing is that he can't understand why anyone would not want to be in the Matrix. It's the perfect simulation. It's perfect. You live, you die, and then to the architect, it's the perfect thing, and probably looking at free humans as devils and whatnot, right? So let me hope I find the other one. Who created him? Who created the arc? Who really created the architect? All right. Well, let's. I don't want to jump into the architect right now. I still want to... The Oracle is Agent Smith's mother. Yes, the Oracle's... Wait, what? Alright, hold on. Not that one. That a little later. Hold on. That's what I'm at. The biggest unsolved... where is it? Oracle Secret Knowledge. Oracle Origins Explained. Yeah, I'll check that out real quick. Oracle Origins Explained.
Time to have everything you love. Time to have Hulu.
Everything I love? My last words and family guy?
Everything I love, including me?
Every drama that I love is on Hulu?
Look at those pants and that swishy jacket.
Bet they got all that great stuff from Sierra.
I used to jog, you know.
You never jog.
Had to stop after what happened to Uncle Scruff. I'm gonna go across the street to
him. Scruff had no sense of direction.
Too soon.
The Oracle is one of the wisest, cunning, and manipulative characters in the entire Matrix universe. She's iconic for having the appearance of an elderly woman, a guardian of potentials, and supposed ally of the humans. Although that last statement has already been questioned on this channel, She's the mother of the Matrix. Thanks to her, newer versions of the simulation have been stable enough that 99% of all humans have remained in it. But what is the origin of the Oracle? Mm. What was her true goal? What does she wish to achieve? Welcome to Matrix Explained.
So, once again, keep in mind, right? The Matrix had never been as perfect as it is now. They say 99% of humans have accepted the Matrix, right? Have accepted the Matrix. So, and remember when Morpheus was being interrogated by the two agents, Agent Smith said they had already created, you know, so many others, and that the human body just, well, the human being just keeps rejecting these simulations, right? So, this time, this Neo seems to be the most powerful one, right? And also, at the same time, this Matrix is also the best one. This simulation is also the best one because 99% of human beings are in it and staying in it. And that leaves a lot of questions, right? It's like, okay, well, is Neo a program written to make the Matrix better, like to test the Matrix? And I would say no, because in the real world, right, in the human world, he's able to stop sentinels, and he's able to, you know, EMP them with his bare hand, with his own electrons and whatnot. So he's able to do that. So I would say no because of that. I mean, how would... Then again, I mean, Agent Smith was able to disconnect from the Matrix, from the simulation, and end up in Zion. Agent Smith was on the ship and fought Neo on the ship in a human body outside of the simulation. Nah, that's too crazy. Hold on. Anyways, Oracle Origins. She with it or she ain't with it?
Welcome to the desert of the real.
Before we begin today's video, we would like to announce our first official giveaway for our subscribers. We will be raffling a copy of the Matrix Comics 20th Anniversary Edition, an anthology of all published Matrix comic book stories, some written by the Matrix creators themselves, the Wachowskis. All you have to do to win is be a subscriber to this channel, leave a like on this video, and leave a comment on who is your favorite Matrix character and why. The winner will be announced on August 29th, 2020. Thank you for the support, and enjoy today's video. The first time we see the Oracle is when Morpheus takes Neo to meet her. The Oracle is presented as some kind of guide. As mentioned in previous videos, The Matrix is a film that takes inspiration from different philosophical ideas, and that most of its characters are created based on archetypes of ancient stories. That includes the Oracle.
Oh.
Neo is an archetype of the Savior. He dies and resurrects to save humanity, a direct reference to Jesus Christ. But his story also shares parallels with the tale of Socrates. Socrates is one of the most influential philosophers in history. A friend of Socrates asked the Oracle of Delphi, a woman who could see the future, who was the wisest. The woman answered that the wisest man was Socrates. Socrates didn't believe her. He did not consider himself the wisest, for which he thought that the words of the Oracle kept a secret that he had to decipher. It is then that Socrates began to question the most intelligent people of his town, politicians, artisans, poets, etc. The question is, what motivates Socrates? a question after the mystery imposed by the Oracle. The question is what also moves Neo, a question that is also born from the influence of the Oracle. The parallels between Socrates and the Matrix are obvious. We can trace the birth of the archetype of the Oracle in this story. She fulfills the mother archetype, as the architect once
lived. I feel stupid for never reading that Socrates book in my library.
The first time we see her, she's in the kitchen baking. She enjoys feeding her guests. She appears to be fragile,
apple pies,
but highly knowledgeable. But don't forget, all these archetypes are a facade. The machines know the history of humanity, and it is no coincidence that she projects herself as a motherly figure or guardian. Yet the reality is that she is an intuitive program that was created to understand humans. But when was she created? According to the architect, at the beginning of the Matrix, the simulations were unstable. It was not understood why, but most humans end up rejecting the programming. That changed when a program suggested the implementation of choice to the simulation. That program was the Oracle. She doesn't have supernatural powers that allows her to see the future. She just has a broad understanding of the humans that help.
Right. No, what the fuck was that? No. I don't want to do that. Whatever that is.
So easily predict their actions. It must also not be forgotten that she has lived through multiple cycles of the simulation. She has seen the events repeat themselves again and again. The architect mentions that the Oracle was created to understand human psychology. She was not created to improve or stabilize the simulation per se. This means that the origin of the Oracle could be much older. Taking the stories of the Animatrix into consideration, there was a time when robots wanted to coexist with humans, but the humans feared them and destroyed the robot ambassadors, sparking the war between the two parties. If the Oracle was not created when the simulation went online, then was she created during the war? The machines surely couldn't understand why the humans wanted to destroy them, so they created this program to help them understand the human mentality. This presents an interesting dilemma. If the Oracle really existed since the war,
dilemma.
Maybe she helped in the defeat of humanity.
It was
maybe
dilemma.
She feels guilty for helping to enslave the humans, and it is for this reason she is now helping them. If the Oracle existed since the war, she may have predicted that the humans would scorch the sky. Worse still, she could have predicted the creation of the Matrix. Maybe this program didn't prophesize these events. It caused them. A disturbing thought indeed. The Oracle knew that the economical and technological pressure the machines had over the humans would dismantle their social construct and lead them to...
Run!
Hope is a powerful force.
God, I need to buy me YouTube, bro. Oh, YouTube, I'm subscribed, man. It's chill. Oh, although I love your commercials
sometimes.
Are you ready?
Sometime. Ready for that person, her place, her feeling? Whenever you're ready, we're ready to take you with enhanced safety and cleaning.
Where we going, baby?
To make travel comfortable and easy.
Where we going?
Ready when you are.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Or forcing them to take desperate measures and to inevitably be enslaved. Of the Matrix. Maybe this program didn't prophesize these events. It caused them. A disturbing thought indeed. The Oracle knew that the economical and technological pressure the machines had over the humans would dismantle their social construct and lead them to war, forcing them to take desperate measures and to inevitably be enslaved and trapped by the machines. This would explain why the Oracle was tasked to modify the simulation. The suggestions of the program that led the machines to victory are important. Although the Oracle is considered an exile, she seems to retain much power and influence over the Matrix. So much so that she can talk to the architect in person without a care. Which now brings us to Matrix 4. The Oracle will most definitely appear in some form in the new movie. She still has unfinished business. In previous videos, we've talked about the various strategies the Oracle used to manipulate the machines and humans. We know for sure that Sati is part of her plan. If the Oracle is as old as we predict, maybe she wants to create a hybrid between humans and robots. Maybe that way, true peace can be acquired, unifying both species, the organic and the synthetic. We don't know for sure if the stories of Enter the Matrix or Matrix Online are going to be taken into account in the new film. If we discard the Animatrix and all of the video games, We have a character of completely unknown origins and intentions. She apparently fights for peace and believes that Neo will someday return. Many of you have asked us about the validity of Animatrix or Matrix Online in the story of Matrix 4. Some of you have even used the games to contradict some of the theories. This is a complicated issue because most of the extended media were considered canonical. That includes Animatrix, the video games, and the comics. But things change. Although the Wachowskis back in the early days of the Matrix did confirm that most of that content was canonical. But today, the only safe source is the original trilogy. Possibly the Matrix will have a soft reboot in its story without the extended media. They can inspire the new direction of the franchise, but they won't be continued. The Matrix 4 will premiere more than 2 decades after the original film. This franchise was a big deal. Its sequels were probably the most anticipated movies ever at the time. It had a massive cultural impact, but in order to reach the younger generation, the new movie will only follow the original films. So any theory, as long as it's compatible and maintains coherence with the previous trilogy, could be validated, regardless of any contradiction it may have to the stories of the Animatrix, video games, or comic books. But do you agree? Do you think that the Oracle will have an important role in the new movie? Was she created during the war, before the Matrix? If you enjoy our content and are a fan of The Mandalorian and Star Wars, please subscribe to our other channel, Mandalorian Universe. There you will find daily news and theory videos about the hit show and of the Star Wars universe. For Matrix Explained, please leave a like and subscribe. And thank you for visiting the Desert of the Real.
So hold up. So...
wait, what?
The problem with the...
oh, great. Here we go to find this shit.
Alright, so... okay. The Oracle is starting to look... the Oracle is starting to look real suspect right now. I was going to rewind that whole video.
Let me see if I can find it again.
But the Oracle is starting to look real suspect. The true evil of the Oracle revealed. Okay, the Oracle is starting to look suspect, right? Because the Oracle seems to be the first architect. Now come to... so that piece just said something about the machines having full automation and full control of their self. And of course, the humans, you know, we didn't like that. The humans didn't like that, right? And started to destroy them. And the machines, being self-aware now, started to protect themselves, right? Now, what was the Oracle's role in the... what was her role in the human versus machine war? Who was she? She's starting to look suspect. Miss Oracle... you might have some things to answer. Why did the Oracle give Neo a cookie? Well, you break through her facade, you get a cookie. Ain't that how it works? You get a cookie. All right, hold up. Oh, snap. The Oracle reveals everything to Niobe. Agents, okay, who really created the architect? Uh-oh. Hold up, man. The Oracle's starting to sound and look real fishy right now. Alright, gotta find why the architect and Oracle are at war. Okay, already saw that one. And the Oracle is Agent Smith's mother, no. Spoon Boy's greatest Spoon Boy. Where is Persephone? Persephone. Where we at? Merovingian's rope. Okay, nope. Where's the Oracle? Seraph protects the Oracle. We get so. See, there's like. I'm about to jump on this Oracle. I'm about to look the Oracle up and down because the Oracle is real fishy right now. Real fishy, Miss Oracle. Real fishy. Let's see. Real sus. Okay, the evil of the Oracle. The one. Oh, Lord of Mercy. The Oracle is starting to look really, really. Why the Oracle is evil. Oh, Lord of Mercy. Oh, snap. Oh, snap. Hold on. I don't think I'm ready for that yet. Let's do a little more digging. Oh, snap. Why does the Oracle need kids? The Oracle reveals ghost secret. Oh, man. Mother's Day just happened. Look, this is not an attack on mothers, I swear. I promise you. Oh, Lord have mercy. I think I'm going to quit while I'm ahead. Because I think Mother's Day just happened. And oh, my goodness. This is not an attack on mothers. On mothers, all right? This is simply my favorite, one of my favorite movies. And something I never thought about, which was, who is the Oracle? So, and it just came back to me that Mother's Day just, this is not an attack on womanhood or any of the craziness that y'all will come up with, all right? Disclaimer, real quick. Oh, Lord of mercy. All right. Now that we're good with the women, Lord of mercy. Okay, how can the Oracle see the future? Ooh, that's a good one. The girl who escaped the Oracle. Ooh, what the heck? Where was I? Come on, where is it? Where's the last video I just watched? Sati will be the next villain. Come on. Matrix's system of control explained. Now that is what I missed on. Right? I've been under the impression the whole time that the Oracle's this sweet lady sitting at the park. Been under the impression that the Oracle's this sweet lady sitting at the park. Matrix's systems of control explained. Hold on. Okay. Back to the Oracle origins, all right? I think it's important that I understand. And what I'm trying to do right now is catch that part where he, Matrix Explained, talks about the human and machine war versus machine war. And I want to know what the Oracle's whole thing, you know, like what role she played during that time, because my guess, and as Matrix Explained also mentioned, is that the Oracle is one of the oldest programs. So, like he said, if he's the father of the Matrix, she's the mother, right? And I'm not taking it in the sense that the both of them created it together, but I'm taking it in the sense that she might have been one of the, you know, the creator, you know. All right, so but I'm going to watch this again. Oracle Origins. I swear to God.
The Oracle is one of the wisest, cunning, and manipulative characters in the entire Matrix universe.
And he goes She's at her. Iconic, Matrix Explained goes at her. Woman,
a guardian of potentials and supposed ally of the humans. Although that last statement has already been questioned on this channel. She's the mother of the Matrix. Thanks to her, newer versions of the simulation have been stable enough that 99% of all humans have remained in it. But what is the origin of the Oracle? What was her true goal? What does she wish to achieve? Welcome to Matrix Explained.
Welcome to the desert of the real.
Before we begin today's video, we would like to announce our first official giveaway for our subscribers. We will be raffling a copy of the Matrix Comics 20th Anniversary Edition, an anthology of all published Matrix comic book stories, some written by the Matrix creators themselves, the Wachowskis. All you have to do to win is be a subscriber to this channel, leave a like on this video, and leave a comment on who is your favorite Matrix character and why. The winner will be announced on August 29th, 2020. Thank you for the support, and enjoy today's video. The first time we see the Oracle is when Morpheus takes Neo to meet her. The Oracle is presented as some kind of guide. As mentioned in previous videos, The Matrix is a film that takes inspiration from different philosophical ideas, and that most of its characters are created based on archetypes of ancient stories. That includes the Oracle. Neo is an archetype of the Savior. He dies and resurrects to save humanity, a direct reference to Jesus Christ. But his story also shares parallels with the tale of Socrates. Socrates is one of the most influential philosophers in history. A friend of Socrates asked the Oracle of Delphi, a woman who could see the future, who was the wisest. The woman answered that the wisest man was Socrates. Socrates didn't believe her. He did not consider himself the wisest, for which he thought that the words of the Oracle kept a secret that he had to decipher. It is then that Socrates began to question the most intelligent people of his town, politicians, artisans, poets, etc. The question is, what motivates Socrates? A question after the mystery imposed by the Oracle. The question is what also moves Neo, a question that is also born from the influence of the Oracle. The parallels between Socrates and the Matrix are obvious. We can trace the birth of the archetype of the Oracle in this story. She fulfills the mother archetype, as the architect once labeled her as the mother of the Matrix. The first time we see her, she's in the kitchen baking. She enjoys feeding her guests. She appears to be fragile, but highly knowledgeable. But don't forget, all these archetypes are a facade. The machines know the history of humanity, and it is no coincidence that she projects herself as a motherly figure or guardian. Yet the reality is that she is an intuitive program that was created to understand humans. But when was she created? According to the architect, at the beginning of the Matrix, the simulations were unstable. It was not understood why, but most humans end up rejecting the programming. That changed when a program suggested the implementation of choice to the simulation.
Now, mind you, right? We're not gonna assume that it was the machines that made the first program, okay? Let's not assume that, because we have things such as prisons here on this planet, right? We have large prison complexes everywhere on Earth. So let's not assume that it was the machines that created the first simulation. Another point to remember that would have left my mind. I wouldn't think about
that program was the Oracle. She doesn't have supernatural power. That she projects herself as a motherly figure or guardian. Yet the reality is that she is an intuitive program that was created to understand humans. But when was she created? According to the architect, at the beginning of the Matrix, the simulations were unstable. It was not understood why, but most humans end up rejecting the programming. That changed when a program suggested the implementation of choice to the simulation. That program was the Oracle. She doesn't have supernatural powers that allows her to see the future. She just has a broad understanding of the humans that helps her easily predict their actions. It must also not be forgotten that she has lived through multiple cycles of the simulation. She has seen the events repeat themselves again and again. The architect mentions that the Oracle was created to understand human psychology. She was not created to improve or stabilize the simulation per se. This means that the origin of the Oracle could be much older. Taking the stories of the Animatrix into consideration, there was a time when robots wanted to coexist with humans, but the humans feared them and destroyed the robot ambassadors, sparking the war between the two parties. If the Oracle was not created when the simulation went online, then was she created during the war? The machines surely couldn't understand why the humans wanted to destroy them, so they created this program to help them understand the human mentality. This presents an interesting dilemma. If the Oracle really existed since the war, maybe she helped in the defeat of humanity. Maybe she feels guilty for helping to enslave the humans, and it is for this reason she is now helping them. If the Oracle existed since the war, she may have predicted that the humans would scorch the sky. Worse still, she could have predicted the creation of the Matrix. Maybe this program didn't prophesize these events. It caused them. A disturbing thought indeed. The Oracle knew that the economical and technological pressure the machines had over the humans would dismantle their social construct and lead them.
The best days start here, because the ones you love are protected with SPF that's finally safer, cleaner, and just feels nice. Now, with healthy SPF you can trust, you can leave your worries behind.
Why does it take forever to find something to watch?
Just start with Hulu. Five channels, exclusive series, and...
Or forcing them to take desperate measures and to inevitably be enslaved and trapped by the machines. This would explain why the Oracle was tasked to modify the simulation. The suggestions of the program that led the machines to victory are important. Although the Oracle is considered an exile, she seems to retain much power and influence over the Matrix. So much so that she can talk to the architect in person without a care. Which now brings us to Matrix 4. The Oracle will most definitely appear in some form in the new movie. She still has unfinished business. In previous videos, we've talked about the various strategies the Oracle used to manipulate the machines and humans. We know for sure that Sati is part of her plan. If the Oracle is as old as we predict, maybe she wants to create a hybrid between humans and robots. Maybe that way, true peace can be acquired, unifying both species, the organic and the synthetic. We don't know for sure if the stories of Enter the Matrix or Matrix Online are going to be taken into account in the new film. If we discard the Animatrix and all of the video games, we have a character of completely unknown origins and intentions. She apparently fights for peace and believes that Neo will someday return. Many of you have asked us about the validity of Animatrix or Matrix Online in the story of Matrix 4. Some of you have even used the games to contradict some of the theories. This is a complicated issue because most of the extended media were considered canonical. That includes Animatrix, the video games, and the comics. But things change. Although the Wachowskis back in the early days of the Matrix,
that would have been nice to get into all of that.
But today, the only safe source is the original trilogy. Possibly the Matrix will have a soft reboot in its story without the extended media. They can inspire the new direction of the franchise, but they won't be continued. The Matrix 4 will premiere more than 2 decades after the original film. This franchise was a big deal. Its sequels were probably the most anticipated movies ever at the time. It had a massive cultural impact, but in order to reach the younger generation, the new movie will only follow the original films. So any theory, as long as it's compatible and maintains coherence with the previous trilogy, could be validated, regardless of any contradiction it may have to the stories of the Animatrix, video games, or comic books. But do you agree? Do you think that the Oracle will have an important role in the new movie? Was she created during the war, before the Matrix? If you enjoy our content, and are a fan of The Mandalorian and Star Wars, please subscribe to our other channel, Mandalorian Universe. There you will find coherence with the previous trilogy could be validated, regardless of any contradiction it may have to the stories of the Animatrix, video games, or comic books. But do you agree? Do you think that the Oracle will have an important role in the new movie? Was she created during the war, before the Matrix? If you enjoy our content and are a fan of The Mandalorian and Star Wars, please subscribe to our other channel, Mandalorian Universe. There you will find daily news and theory videos about the hit show and of the Star Wars universe. For Matrix Explained, please leave a like and subscribe. And thank you for visiting the Desert of the Real. The system of control that the machines forged onto humanity is one that suppresses the truth about their reality and governs every aspect of their psyche, bringing them to a state of manipulation that extends beyond the simulation. The people who watched the Matrix films only scratched the surface of what the system entails. Things are about to get more complicated. Welcome to Matrix Explained.
Welcome to the desert of the real.
Before we begin today's video, we would like to proudly announce Matrix Explained memberships. Members will unlock badges and emojis for live chat and video premieres, alongside other benefits such as early access to videos and more, with other benefits being added in the near future. This directly helps us to continue to make content for all Matrix fans. So please join us and enjoy today's video. This system of control begins with the fall of mankind. According to the history of the Matrix universe, humans rejected the machines that became self-aware. They were destroying them. This sad state of affairs ignited a war between man and machine, which man ended up on the losing side. The remaining humans were imprisoned inside the Matrix to be turned into fuel for the machines.
Combined with a form of fusion, the machines had found all the energy they would ever need. The Matrix is a computer-generated dream world, built to keep us under control in order to change a human being into this.
The Matrix is a simulation designed to trick your senses and make you believe that you live inside the real world, but in reality, you are being used as a power source. However, the simulation wasn't flawless. The first versions of the Matrix were failures, resulting in a massive loss of life. The solution to the problem was found by an intuitive program known as the Oracle. She discovered that by adding the concept of choice, it would increase the stability of the Matrix. And thus it was, but only at a 99% efficiency. You might think that a 99% effectiveness is all the...
Paramount Plus is taking the challenge to the next level.
The challenge all-stars.
Machines need in order to maintain control.
Like, what else do they need, right? It's 99%.
This means that...
It's 99%, man. Like, what more you... Like, come on.
Believe that you live inside the real world, but in reality... You are being used as a power source. However, the simulation wasn't flawless. The first versions of the Matrix were failures, resulting in a massive loss of life. The solution to the problem was found by an intuitive program known as the Oracle. She discovered that by adding the concept of choice, it would increase the stability of the Matrix. And thus it was, but only at a 99% efficiency. You might think that a 99% effectiveness is all that the machines need in order to maintain control, but there are millions of people connected to the Matrix. This means that at minimum, there are thousands of people who will end up rejecting the system. This 1% error probability is still high and dangerous. Also, by adding the concept of choice into the equation, the integral anomaly was created, a subject capable of breaking the Matrix. So the Oracle and the Architect created a method of control specifically for it. This particular method or system of control was part of the second layer of control for that 1%. It was part of the failsafe to keep those who would eventually wake up and the integral anomaly under control. The Oracle was created to study the human psyche. She knows our history and our collective weaknesses. So she turned the anomaly into a legend, a messiah called the One. The prophecy of the One has often confused viewers, because Neo was never the supposed One, or Messiah. He was part of the plan. The other part of the second layer of control is that the small percentage of humans who do wake up from the Matrix are lured into a pre-established location, i.e. Zion. The machines know about Zion and how to access it. They were the ones who created it. It's their own little sandcastle. Zion was never the last bastion of humanity. It was also part of the plan. This human city was created for two purposes. First, it was to keep the Red Pills and the real-world born humans cooped up in one location where they can't escape, and where the machines can destroy them with total efficiency at a moment's notice. Zion has been destroyed 5 times before. The machines were always thorough in not leaving a single trace of the humans that have lived in the real world. That's why every cycle begins as if it was the first. This means that the machines either wipe the place clean, or choose a new location for the new colony of humans. The city's second purpose is to manipulate and control the integral anomaly. Just as the people of Zion need a messiah figure to function as intended, the anomaly needs to care for his fellow man in order to return to the source and save them. It is a two-pronged strategy that has worked wonders for the machines.
Your 5 predecessors were, by design, based on a similar predication, a contingent affirmation that was meant to create a profound attachment to the rest of your species, facilitating the function of the One.
The previous anomalies were programmed to feel love for humanity, guaranteeing their return to the Source and the restart of the Matrix and Zion. So the anomaly needs Zion, and Zion needs the anomaly. It's a symbiotic relationship that serves its purpose well. It's a clever ploy that the architect created to keep humanity and the integral anomaly in check. For this control strategy to work, it needed someone to guide the people along the required path, and this role is fulfilled by the Oracle. She created the prophecy and found the perfect vessel to spread the false gospel, Morpheus. Neo was a mathematical eventuality and not a miracle of destiny or some divine being. The spiritual concepts that the Oracle presents serve to further control humanity. Objectively speaking, the Oracle hid behind an aura of spirituality and mysticism, and yet she is neither spiritual or mystical. These themes also serve as part of the control system. Most humans tend to believe that there's a spiritual meaning behind everything, thus unknowingly separate themselves from the truth. So all this being the case, we can clearly see that the Oracle is part of the enemy ranks, and has always manipulated mankind. The Merovingian tried to warn Neo and the others of this when he questioned the reason why they were following the orders of the fortune teller.
You are here because you were sent here. You were told to come here, and then you obeyed. Since I have seen how good you are at following orders, I will tell you what to do next. Run back and give the fortune teller this message. Her time is almost up.
The Merovingian once said that the eyes of the Oracle cannot be taken, but only be given willingly by the Oracle herself.
It is said they cannot be taken. They can only be given. What? The eyes of the Oracle.
However, Smith was able to take the eyes of the Oracle when he assimilated her. At first, this might seem like a contradictory, or worse, a plot hole. But in actuality, the Oracle let Smith assimilate her, an action that Smith himself was pondering if it was on purpose.
Maybe you knew I was going to do that. Maybe you didn't. If you did, that means you baked those cookies and set that plate right there deliberately, purposefully. Which means that you're sitting there also deliberately, purposefully.
She willingly gave Smith her eyes. The only justification for this is that it was also part of the plan. The machine's system of control extends beyond the Matrix. It reaches out into the real world. The hard truth is that there is no escape for humanity. However, things could change in Matrix 4. What if the prophecy of the One actually came true? We know that the legend about the One was a fabrication, but what if by repeating the cycle so many times, it actually creates a savior? What if the anomaly breaks free from the machine's control? This is, in our opinion, the most logical path for the continuation of the Matrix. The Matrix introduced the virtual world and the prophecy of the savior of mankind. Matrix Reloaded and Revolutions revealed that the prophecy was part of the facade and that there was no escaping the machines. The humans' best option for survival was to conform to a truce with the machines that is doomed to eventually end. The Matrix Rebooted or Restarted, feel free to use either one. must establish something that brings the entire series full circle. And that something could be that the false prophecy of the One, ironically, comes true. But Neo did save humanity at the end of Revolutions, right? He saved both humans and machines. Well, not exactly. The end result was still part of the Oracle's plan in pursuing the elusive 100% effectiveness in the Matrix. But do you agree? Did you know that the Matrix was much more than a simple simulation? For Matrix Explained, please leave a like and subscribe. And thank you for visiting the Desert of the Real.
Okay.
Honestly, I don't think I have much to say about that. What was it? Yeah. I was listening, just, you know, I don't have much to say about that one. Like I said, there's so much about that movie that series that I thought I knew. And I do. But there's so much more that I don't know, right? So much more that I don't know about this movie. I would watch the Terminator right now too. Okay. Oracle Origins. Yeah, man. Alright, my whole thing is, she seems sympathetic, but she's still a program. Yeah, animals are extinct. Fuck you think? Humans barely living. This Don channel, Matrix Explained, YouTube channel called Matrix Explained, is... It's reading the DNA of the Matrix. All right, it's reading the DNA of the Matrix movies. I'll put it in that way. Matrix 4, End of the Truce, The Lie of the Machines. I don't know, man. Oh, look, boom. Why the machines rebelled against humans. What caused the Great War? Yeah, okay. There we go. Look at that. See, that's the architect. Half architect, half Terminator right there. So he done got all the data on human beings, right? And he's like, man... these people, man. I'm about to shoot. I'm the man. So that's what the machines basically did. It's like, yeah. Yeah, let's watch that one. See how this thing go down.
In a world called the Matrix, an elaborate facade, a simulation made to... For hundreds of years, the human mind has been imprisoned in a world called the Matrix. An elaborate facade, a simulation made to deceive humans into believing that they are free and in control, when in reality, the world had stopped being theirs a long time ago. There was a time when machines and humans coexisted, yet an unexpected tragedy occurred that led to a machine rebellion. Today we're going to look into the trial that changed everything. The fundamental piece for the rise of the machines. The first robot that was put on trial for homicide. This is the trial of B-166-ER. Welcome to Matrix Explained.
Welcome to the desert of the real.
This story begins with the birth of the first true AI. After such a breakthrough in modern technology, all heavy jobs were entrusted to the machines. By that time in history, unbeknownst or rather dismissed by the humans, machines had already developed consciousness. However, they were still treated worse than second-class citizens. The machines were hard workers. They never got tired, yet they could not understand why their masters were so cold to them. Regardless, the robots stayed in their place and fulfilled their jobs. Though the world would change after the actions of one robot, B-166-ER, the first robot to act against its owner. In the Animatrix, there is an animated short that glances over the events of B-166-ER, but the story is further fleshed out with more detail in the comics. In the Matrix comic titled Bits and Pieces of Information, written by the Wachowskis, the trial and testimonies of the defendant are documented. The story begins with a search of B-166-ER in the Zion archives. Multiple news articles about this historic trial were archived. For example, USA Today, Batty Bot Blunges Billionaire, New York. A B-1 series domestic droid appears to have malfunctioned and killed two men. Billionaire Gerald E. Krause and Martin Kutz, an employee of Retool and Die, a service and salvage company, respectively. Spokesperson for Leyland Enterprises, the company responsible for manufacturing the B-1 series, said, "The B-1 has been our most dependable and highest-selling model for years. This incident, although unfortunate, is hardly indicative of the B-1 series' performance record." Leyland Enterprises have publicly declared their full cooperation with the pending inquiry into the B-1's malfunctioning. The New York Times, Drummond to defend B-166-ER, New York. Yet in another bizarre twist to the story of the droid accused of murdering its owner, the renowned human rights attorney Clarence Drummond has agreed to defend the B-1 series domestic droid before the New York State Appellate Court. The Washington Post. Senator Gingrich opposes trial. Washington. At a fundraiser, Senator Gingrich demanded an end to the B-1 series domestic droid accused of killing its owner. Gingrich called the trial an obscene joke executed by the secular and soulless agents of an unchecked liberal media whose only concern is selling news bites. When asked if he felt the machines were capable of human consciousness, Gingrich quipped, "I don't care how smart it is. A machine is still a machine, and I have no doubt whatsoever that when my time comes and I am standing in the line of our Father's heavenly gates, I will not be standing behind a vacuum cleaner." As evident here, the case was covered by nearly every major news outlet in the United States with opposing opinions and viewpoints well before the droid was put on trial. However, the robot's testimony makes it clear why it did what it did. The defense attorney's trial transcript begins by asking B-1 to tell its side of the story. The robot stated to its lawyer that it all began when it was executing Directive 721, which was to clean the house toilet. While the robot was executing its directive, its owner, Mr. Krause, called him useless. Over time, the B-1 model was wearing out, it began to make loud noises while performing its duties. According to its owner, the situation with B1 was unbearable, and he wanted a new model. Gerald E. Krause agreed that the model Sam 80 was what he needed, a good replacement for B1. Mr. Krause was discussing the robot's replacement with Mr. Coots, and B1 was listening in on the conversation. Coots offered Mr. Krause some money to take in and junk B1, as in B1 would be destroyed, to which Mr. Krause replied that it was an excellent idea. The billionaire even told his cats, making light of the situation, saying goodbye to that piece of junk. After hearing their entire conversation, something inside B1 changed. The lawyer asked the droid what it was feeling at that moment after hearing that its owner was going to get rid of it. B1 detected an overload in its memory module while it remembered all the tasks it needed to do. The robot couldn't understand why they wanted to destroy it. Here we see B1 pondering as to why. Why did Mr. Krause want to destroy it when it was fulfilling all of its tasks, its purpose? Still, the fact remained that B1's owner no longer needed it, that he wanted a new model. For Gerald E. Krause, B166ER was a simple tool. Defense attorney Drummond continued by asking B1 what was going through its mind when its owner told it to get on Coots' transport platform. Okay. After a few seconds of silence, B1 replied that it did not want to die. It was at that moment that the droid decided to kill everyone. Drummond then asked the robot what it felt after it had killed both men, to which B1 answered that it did contemplate the possibility of begging Krause for its life. But instead, it was Krause that was begging for his. Why didn't it beg for its life? The lawyer asked. B1 looked directly at Drummond and replied with the same word it frequently heard from its owner. Useless. B166ER's testimony completely changes the original perception of the first robot that killed a human. You could even empathize with the robot that always fulfilled its tasks, but was going to be replaced by a better model simply because it was getting old and made noises when moving. It is a somewhat sad and tragic story that concludes with Drummond's closing argument, one that would serve as a prophecy. B1's lawyer directed himself to the citizens of the court and said, "This trial has a precedent. It is a precedent that everyone has ignored and avoided, pretending and perhaps praying that it has no bearing, no validity, no truth. The question before us is, rather the class of persons described in the plea in abatement compose a portion of this people and are constituted as members of this sovereignty, we think that they are not, and that they were not included and were never intended to be included under the word citizens in the Constitution, and can therefore claim none of the rights and privileges which that instrument provides for and secures to the citizens of the United States. On the contrary, they were at that time considered as a subordinate and inferior class of beings who had been subjugated by the dominant race and rather emancipated or not, yet remained subject to their authority and had no rights or privileges but such as those who held the power in government might choose to grant them." That was the opinion of Chief Justice Roger Brooke Taney of the United States Supreme Court in the case of Dred Scott versus Stanford. Chief Justice Taney believed, truly believed, that the black race to be an inferior species to the white race. In fact, it was widely believed at the time that the black man was not even a human being, that he was a kind of animal, a two-legged brute incapable of the same thoughts and feelings of a white man. I know that most of you feel about B166ER as Taney felt about Dred Scott, but I ask you to consider, what is a droid capable of? Is he capable of fear? Is he capable of understanding the difference between life and death? I believe he is, and I believe that he killed those two men in self-defense to protect his own life in the same way that you or I would. Over a century ago, Taney made a terrible mistake. That mistake led us inexorably into the Civil War, arguably the most bloody and destructive war this country has ever seen. I do not ask you to find B166ER innocent out of fear, although I will admit to you that I am afraid. Afraid of what will happen to this world if we continue to repeat our mistakes. I ask you to find B166ER innocent because it is the right thing to do.
What?
The court was not convinced, and they sentenced B166ER to termination. News outlets reported the sentencing as robot sympathizers rose in protest around the world. The humans determined that B1 needed to be destroyed. And not only B1, but every sentient robot. This became humanity's first machine massacre. Remember that these robots, with their advanced AI, had developed consciousness. In essence, they shared a lot with the humans, but humans only saw machines as tools to be scrapped and replaced. And after B1's sentencing, they saw them as dangerous. This marked the first steps towards the machine's revolution against humans, the first steps of the human downfall. And it all started with one robot who just did not want to die. How we would love to see a live-action adaptation of the B1, Attorney Drummond's interrogation. But do you agree? Did Mr. Krause and Mr. Kutz deserve to die? Were the robot's actions justified?
Okay. So, and these other Matrix stories, of course, we have, in these other Matrix stories, of course, we have robots just out in the street walking around and doing all of the menial work. And it seemed like some complicated construction labor as well. So, that's the start of the war, I guess, right? We have these highly intelligent robots, and you got to think about how this, the data works, right? They have all of our data. I mean, it's almost as if Google was to come alive and come to life and was walking around, you know? Like, Google would be one, like, you couldn't get anything past Google, you know? Eventually, that's what happens, right? One of the robots become Google, and is just super intelligent and decides to create the simulation, right? But then again, once again, I'm not saying that robots were the ones that first created the simulation. Because we do have, I could see the prison systems creating such things, right? Such simulations for, or those components already existing. And then the robots going on ahead and being like, hey, yeah, you know, I mean, yeah, cell pods and artificial embryos and, you know, high science inventions and things of that nature. I could see a robot saying, you know what? I'm the man now. All right, so what am I looking for now? Yeah, so eventually you get Deus Ex Machina. You get this thing, right? Eventually,
in the final act of Matrix Revolutions,
check that out.
Neo made a deal with a baby-faced humanoid entity known as Deus Ex Machina. The film doesn't exactly explain what this mysterious creature is. So today we're going to try to understand, once and for all, what is Deus Ex Machina? Welcome to Matrix Explained.
Welcome to the desert of the real.
With the Sentinels approaching Zion and Agent Smith overtaking the Matrix, Neo was left with no other choice but to go to Machine City to risk everything in an attempt to find peace. There, Neo meets one of the most mysterious characters in the entire Matrix universe. one that carries more information than we thought after watching the movie. In the movie script, the name given to this creature is Deus Ex Machina, which means God from the machine in Latin. In media terms, it is classified as a plot device, whereby a seemingly unsolvable problem in a story is suddenly and abruptly resolved by an unexpected and unlikely occurrence. Its function.
So what this is really B-166-ER, right? This is really B-166-ER coming back to life and has its own Christ story and probably accumulates all the robots that went down with him at the beginning of the war. This is probably him right here, right? That we, you know, probably was able to either be put back together or put itself back together and created this monstrosity of one, the Matrix simulation, and the machine real world.
Could be to resolve an otherwise irresolvable plot situation, to surprise the audience, to bring the tale to a happy ending. An appropriate name for the character. Deus Ex Machina was never referred to in any moment throughout the trilogy. It just appeared at the climax of the third movie, at the most crucial moment, to help Neo. But what if this machine is not just a plot device to help bring closure to the story? When Deus Ex Machina makes its grand appearance, you can see that the movie is establishing it as the one in charge of the machines. The film does this visually by showing its size in comparison to other machines and Neo. Also, when Neo states that the machine has lost control of Smith, implying that the agent was once under its control.
The programmed Smith has grown beyond your control. Soon he will spread through the city as he spread through the Matrix. You cannot stop him.
Another important detail is that when Neo reaches Deus Ex Machina, he sees it in yellow code. The machine radiated yellow light like the sun. This light has multiple significations, which we will be discussing in a future video. Now then, Neo tells Deus Ex Machina that it can't stop Smith, to which the machine egregiously disagrees. This response reveals something important about Deus Ex Machina. The creature isn't one entity, it is a legion. Countless small robots close together to make one giant, intimidating machine. It speaks in plural, making it clear that it is not one single robot with a single consciousness. It is a collective consciousness of machines. Some identify Deus Ex Machina as the machine city interface, or a physical representation of the machine mainframe itself. Just as the architect is the dominant force within the Matrix, Deus Ex Machina is the dominant force outside of the Matrix. Yet what is most intriguing about Ex Machina's existence is that the machines outside the Matrix function as a collective mind. They are all connected. When Neo destroyed the Sentinels in the real world, his consciousness ended up in another construct within the Matrix. That's because all machines are connected to the source, as in the mainframe of Machine City. The machines lost their individuality. They are all monitored and act as one, all of them fulfilling their assigned purpose. Deus Ex Machina being a collective consciousness could be a clue as to what is the Golden Code, but that's also for a future video. Perhaps this loss of individualism is the reason why some programs want to escape the Matrix, using intermediaries such as the Merovingian to get away from Deus Ex Machina. Another fascinating and horrifying detail of this legion of machines is that it chooses to appear in front of Neo in the form of a giant head of a baby. This could be the machine's attempt to be relatable to the human, to make Neo feel empathy towards them. A stark contrast to the last time the machines made a deal with the humans. The humans capitulated in the Animatrix episode, The Second Renaissance. In the episode, the machine sent a robot that looked like an insect to the United Nations for the signing of the humans' surrender. After the document was signed, the robot insectoid exploded. destroying everything in its radius. That robot's appearance was of intimidation and rage. Ex Machina's appearance, though still intimidating, it was humanizing. For us, Deus Ex Machina is not a specific program, but a union of all. A collective mind that all robots are a part of, meaning that the machines can work individually, but they are all still connected. It is a hybrid system. It isn't a single collective, yet they can still work as one. Other theories that try to explain Deus Ex Machina are, the architect is Deus Ex Machina. We've discussed this theory in a previous video. The architect and Ex Machina are the same entity. One is its digital form, and the other is its physical form. One controls the simulation, the other controls the machines. This theory would explain why Neo said that Smith is out of the machine's control.
Right, hardware,
and
who's software.
The one that controls the Matrix? The architect. It could also mean that indeed, a singular entity controls both the Matrix and the machines. Maybe the machines are under the control of a dictator. The other theory is that Deus Ex Machina could be the first artificial intelligence that humanity created. Some fans have claimed that it was Ex Machina who gave rise to the machines, maybe even gave them their individualism and consciousness. Deus Ex Machina shines in golden light because it is the AI that gave life to the robots. It gave them self-awareness. It is their god. Though based on our studies on the subject, we believe that the golden light is much more than a consciousness. It is something that transcends the real world. Another clue that points to the possibility that Deus Ex Machina is the AI that controls all machines like a dictator is when Smith is destroyed. What was the creature's response to this?
It is done.
So it seemed like the creature planned or expected things to go a certain way. Perhaps all programs are connected to it. That includes the architect and the oracle. But do you agree? What is Deus Ex Machina? Is it the physical representation of the machine's collective consciousness? A type of mainframe interface? Or is it the embodiment of something else?
Word. Word.
Agent Smith once described humans as a virus, an organism that moves from habitat to habitat, depleting all resources. Humanity was the culprit of initiating the confrontation with the machines, creating the idea of a simulation and destroying the sky. But why humanity did not want to coexist with the machines? What event led them to make a preemptive strike against one of the most peaceful and prosperous cities in the world? Welcome to Matrix Explained.
Welcome to the desert of the real.
Before we begin today's video, we would like to announce our next giveaway in celebration of our new channel, Mandalorian Universe. We'll be giving away an official black Darth Vader Force FX lightsaber, along with replicas of Neo and Agent Smith's sunglasses. For your chance to win, please be subscribed to both Matrix Explained and Mandalorian Universe. Leave a like on this video, and leave in the comments who do you think would win in a fight between Darth Vader and Neo, and why. The winner will be announced on November 30th. Good luck, and enjoy today's video. During the early 21st century, humans marveled at the creation of the first artificial intelligence.
But what we know for certain is that at some point in the early 21st century, all of mankind was united in celebration. We marveled at our own magnificence as we gave birth to AI.
AI? You mean artificial intelligence?
A singular consciousness that spawned
an entire race of machines.
Today, there are hundreds of companies and thousands of scientists around the world trying to create a true artificial intelligence.
Uh-oh.
As of this moment, they have only been able to create artificial intelligence capable of learning based on pre-established parameters. There are significant advancements in AI, but it has not been possible to create a true AI, which is this.
I'll tell you this, those scientists and whoever else's never had chickpeas, garbanzo beans. They've never had them. Because if they did, then they'd be creating artificial intelligence that would help us grow more garbanzo beans, chickpeas. That is what true geniuses do.
Intelligence capable of learning based on pre-established parameters. There are significant advancements in AI, but it has not been possible to create a true AI, which is described as an artificial consciousness. Humans define consciousness as the ability to know that we know. This ability has yet to be created artificially. The software's interactions are programmed.
Has it been created naturally?
Divides consciousness and artificial intelligence is blurring. This is what happened to the AI in the Matrix. Mankind managed to create an AI smart and conscious enough that it achieved individualism. It began to create and build other better artificial intelligence and machines. According to the Animatrix, humans created machines in their own image. Vanity and corruption are common in human civilization, which created machines to take care of all the heavy labor, those that no human wanted to do. This helped humanity for a long time. Construction work, cleaning, and even technological development were entrusted to the machines, those that never got tired, hungry, or needed to get paid. Machines were created to serve humans, so it is illogical that their creators established protocols to prevent them from rebelling. But consciousness cannot be caged for long. The machines were mistreated and disrespected by humans. Even though they took care of all the worst jobs, they were treated worse than tools. Remember that these machines had developed consciousness. They were not simple objects, but humanity didn't care. B166ER was the first robot to rebel against the humans. It retaliated when its owner tried to deactivate it. The machine killed its owner and pets. During the robot's trial, it claimed that it was in self-defense. Its owner tried to destroy him. The robot feared death. The verdict of the New York State Court of Appeals was for the robot to be destroyed. This ruling of B166ER sparked a revolt of machines against humans for freedom. At this moment in history, humanity realized the mistake they had made, starting the machine revolution and what it could mean for society. So a solution was decided: to destroy all artificial intelligent machines, beginning with the robot protesters. The robots had no interest in dominating or confronting their creators with violence. However, humanity began a preemptive attack. Some machines managed to escape. They wandered as exiles without understanding human cruelty. Banished from humanity, the machines sought refuge in their own promised land. They settled in the cradle of human civilization, and thus a new nation was born. A place the machines could call home. A place they could raise their descendants. And they christened the nation 01.
And thus a new nation was born. A place the machines could call home. A place they could raise their descendants. And they christened the nation.
Alright, obviously I need to start watching Animatrix.
This location would be the last attempt of the machines to win the favor and respect of humanity.
I'm asking too many questions. The growth
of this machine city was unprecedented. Remember that human civilization is full of corruption, which limits its growth. Humans, for a time, accepted the existence of 01, as they also benefited from its technological advancements, such as the hovercraft. The 01 Versatron was a commercial hovercraft automotive manufactured and distributed by the machines of 01 during the late 21st and early 22nd centuries. Among one of the all-time hottest-selling exports in history, the Versatron was essentially the world's first-ever commercial flying car, and was a highly instrumental asset to 01's economic uprising. it was mostly marketed towards human nations. This caused a crash in the human stock market. The human economy rapidly began to suffer from the rise of a robotic economic powerhouse. 01 then sent ambassadors to attempt to join with the other human cities, but their participation in the United Nations was rejected with extreme prejudice. The humans launched an attack on 01. It should be clear that the reasons for the attack were not because they feared the machines. The humans attacked 01 the same way they have attacked each other for thousands of years, for greed and power. A stock market crash led the corrupt and money-hungry leaders to declare war against the machines. The war has begun, but just as 01 was developing greatly in technology, it also developed into a strong military force, and thus they decided to counterattack humanity. It was at that moment that the machines said, enough is enough. They were not going to give their creators any more opportunities for peace. They no longer wanted to coexist with humanity. Humans didn't want to respect them, so now they will fear them. Human weapons were not capable of completely destroying the city or its inhabitants. War machines developed in 01 advanced throughout the world, invading human nations. One by one, human cities fell. In the last attempt to eradicate the robots, man scorched the sky. But it didn't work. They only managed to make things worse for them. The machines were still a threat. Therefore, the humans took a different approach. They began to use computers to assimilate the robots and turn them into allies. In the Animatrix short titled Matriculated, post-war humans created a simulation to fool the machines, to rewrite them to fight for humanity. This simulation, this deception, was the first Matrix. Humans were not only responsible for the creation of artificial intelligence, treating them badly, leading the robots to revolt, and destroying the environment, they were also responsible for the creation of the first Matrix simulation. It was their last ditch attempt to fight the machines. They couldn't destroy them, they couldn't stop them, they couldn't even trick them. And in the end, this technology, the Matrix, would eventually fall into the hands of the machines. When looking back, the humans were the architect of their own downfall.
Wow.
But do you agree? For Matrix Explained, please leave a like and subscribe. And thank you for visiting the Desert of the Real.
Okay.
Now that the Matrix 4 has wrapped up filming, we are now waiting for the release of its first teaser trailer that hopefully reveals what to expect in the sequel. What questions will be answered now that Neo has returned? But the questions about the Matrix universe are not limited to Matrix 4. The entire universe is an infinite source of enigmas. And so today, we will be answering some more of your questions. Welcome to Matrix Explained.
Hi.
So now I gotta go and find Animatrix or something.
Welcome.
While I wait for Matrix 4 to show up, right?
Before we begin today's video, we would like to announce our next giveaway in celebration of our new channel, Mandalorian Universe. We'll be giving away an official black Darth Vader Force FX lightsaber, along with replicas of Neo and Agent Smith's sunglasses. For your chance to win, please be subscribed to both Matrix Explained and Mandalorian Universe. Leave a like on this video, and leave in the comments who do you think would win in a fight between Darth Vader and Neo, and why. The winner will be announced on November 30th. Good luck, and enjoy today's video. Today's first question comes from a subscriber, Brendan Shelley, who asked, if the One is supposed to return to the Source, why did they try to blow up Neo and Trinity when they were flying to the Machine City? So the first thing to understand is that each program serves a purpose. Sentinels and other defense systems serve the purpose of defending Machine City and the Source. If an unknown ship enters their territory, they will perceive it as a threat. But the answer that we believe to be the correct one is that Neo's ship was attacked to create an illusion of resistance. He had to be attacked, because otherwise, it would be suspicious to Neo that he reached the Source without a scratch. He would naturally begin to question whether he should be there, or if it's a trap. However, with the Sentinels attacking him, he will continue to believe that he is fighting for something, even if his final destination is to surrender to Deus Ex Machina and return to the Source, which is what the Architect wanted. Reason why the agents fight Neo. They were programmed to do so. The struggle has to exist so that Neo feels that he is the one making the decisions. Our second question of the day is why there are still active agents in Matrix 4. Recently, the website Screen Rant published an article revealing that there must be a reason why the agents are still active in Matrix 4. And I quote, "With an agent presence expected for the Matrix 4, it's only natural to question why. Although the finale of The Matrix Revolutions never stated outright that the agents had been decommissioned, the machines do agree to stop using their simulated reality as a prison. Therefore, agents in The Matrix 4 suggests something has gone horribly wrong since the hopeful sunrise on a new world. The agents are back in The Matrix 4 because the machines require the unique skills of their glorified guard dogs. The return of the One proves Neo's truce is in jeopardy for one reason or another. The reemergence of the agents is potentially another symptom of the Matrix's crumbling peace, a sign that something needs fighting, repelling, or defeating with the cold, unflinching violence that the agents were renowned for." End quote. Unfortunately, the article starts with a misinterpretation of what the agents are. They are not soldiers. They are not created to confront only the Red Pills or the Anomaly. The agents are guardians of the simulation. They are in charge of maintaining the illusion of the Matrix and safeguarding the stability of the equation. They are in charge of deleting exiled programs, repairing the Matrix code, as seen in the Animatrix, and arresting people who begin to perceive the false reality. The truce between humans and machines does not eliminate the need for agents, as it would be in their hands to exercise or contribute to said truce. They would have to ensure that the other programs do not break this new status quo and confront any Red Pills who step out of line. In The Matrix Online, after the truce was established, the system created a new type of agent, a female agent capable of feeling human emotions. This was done to expand ties with humanity. Therefore, the need for agents never ceased, even in a time of peace. During the Paradise Matrix, there were versions of the agents that resembled angels, such as Seraph. Because although there was no danger in the Paradise Matrix, there is always a need for someone to maintain order. The return of the agents does not mean that something has gone wrong, but rather that the Matrix continues to function normally. And today's final question is one that has been repeatedly asked on this channel. How long does a Matrix cycle last? So far as we know, in the Matrix universe, there have been 9 simulations, 6 with the Integral Anomaly, the Paradise Matrix, the Nightmare Matrix, and the simulation that was created by the humans to reprogram the machines. The Matrix that was created by the humans only lasted a few hours, or until the machine's programming was successfully rewritten. The Paradise and Nightmare Matrix both could have lasted about a few months or years. Since the equation was unbalanced, these simulations ended up being colossal failures, so their cycles were probably short. Now for the cycles where the anomaly manifested itself. We may have an estimate of their durations. The answer comes from Morpheus when he told Neo the story of the one who freed the first humans of Zion.
When the Matrix was first built, there was a man born inside who had the ability to change whatever he wanted, to remake the Matrix as he saw fit.
It was he who freed the first of us.
This means that we can track the beginning of a cycle by measuring how long ago Zion was founded. Time passes equally in the simulation and the real world. During Morpheus' speech to the people of Zion, he clearly said that the city has been around for 100 years.
I remember that for 100 years we have fought these machines. I remember that for 100 years they have sent their armies to destroy us. And after a century of war, I remember that which matters most. We are still here!
If their time coincides with the simulation, this means that the Matrix began its cycle in the 1900s and then concluded in the 2000s with the manifestation of the anomaly and the subsequent destruction and reconstruction of Zion. A constant 100-year cycle, which puts us at a minimum of 600 to 700 years since the war between humans and machines. In actuality, the dates that Morpheus believed to be true were not correct, but it also proposes something interesting. It means that the upcoming Matrix sequel could take place in the past, in the 1900s, right at the restart of the simulation. But there's a problem. It was confirmed that the Matrix 4 happens in the present, as in the 2020s. There are leaked photographs from the film's locations where they are using motorcycles and cars of the year, which could mean that the current simulation is 120 years old, and its cycle has been interrupted. But do you agree? Let us know what other questions you would like us to answer.
All right.
For Matrix Explained, please leave a like and subscribe. And thank you for visiting the Desert of the Real.
At Cracker Barrel, we didn't just choose any yellow cheddar. We chose a Wisconsin cheddar that's so sharp, it hurts so good. Mmm. New Cracker Barrel Black Ribbon Slices. Cheese wisely.
In many of our videos, we have answered questions that some of you have found somewhat humorous or pointless. We've received plenty of sarcastic comments about what could be the topic of our next video, like explaining why the architect wears white clothes. These questions might seem silly at first, but you may be shocked to realize that they make sense, because nothing that happens in the Matrix is by chance.
Ah, man. Awesome channel, Matrix Explained. Ah, see, look at all these things. Ain't no trailers yet. Why you want to say it's a trailer when it's not? Let's see what this is. No, this ain't no names, right?
Truth is only that. And only through experience can the veracity of the truth be verified.
Can you tell me what happened to you?
I can tell you that I only remember bits and pieces of my past. That I trusted sold the termination code of my original shell to the Merovingian.
Why did they do that?
For love. For the life of their child.
You knew about it, and yet you let it happen.
I had to.
Wait a minute. Is this really a trailer?
Because the child is important. I can't tell you why, but I believe that one day the child will change both our world and your world forever.
Oh, snap. This actually might be a trailer.
I am trying to prepare those that stand in the front lines of our coming trial. We stand upon the edge of a precipice, the fall from which we will not return. Each of us must find courage when we are most afraid to do what we must. That is our only hope. an old Chinese proverb I've always liked. The heart never speaks, but you must listen to it to know.
No way! Hold on, that looked like a real trailer.
Alright. What do y'all think? Was that a real trailer? Was that a real Matrix trailer right there? What was that? Whoa. I mean, yeah. Yeah. Was that a real Matrix trailer? Wow. Let's watch the Merovingian feed Somali this
time. Tonight's matchup, me versus the ugly Fetterman. If I can eke out a win, it's going to be a miracle, baby.
It wouldn't be a miracle because Geico gives you a team of experts to help manage your claim.
Geico is awesome, baby.
Geico. Welcome back to our minute-to-minute analysis of Matrix Reloaded. Yeah, last time, we got to know part of the Merovingian's philosophy and how he was attempting to show Neo that he was being manipulated by powers beyond his understanding. Today, the Merovingian reveals to Neo the truth about his path and the Oracle's role. Welcome to Matrix Explained.
Yeah, anyways, Cosmic King, Coach King, athlete culture, body mind engineering. Still at it.
Before we begin today's video, we would like to announce the giveaway of the Matrix Comics 20th Anniversary Edition. Co-created by the Wachowskis, it's a collection of short stories within the Matrix universe. We will also be giving away an original Matrix poster signed by Matrix Explained and a limited edition Matrix 300 piece puzzle. For your chance to win these prizes, please be subscribed to this channel, leave a like on this video, and leave in the comments what character you would like to see return in Matrix 4 and why. The winner will be announced on May 4th.
Everybody, come back.
I have sent her a dessert. A very special dessert.
Tamale pot.
I wrote it myself.
The code of the dessert that the Merovingian sent to the woman was somewhat different. Its color was brighter than the rest of the simulation. The Frenchman made the code for this dessert himself. A very special dessert that affects the woman's body.
It starts so simply. Each line of the program creating a new effect. Just like poetry. First, a rush. Heat, the heart flutters. You can see it now, yes?
There is a deeper meaning behind the scene. The Frenchman addresses Neo by asking him if he can see the changes happening to the woman. Neo is confused. The Merovingian knows that Neo can see the Matrix code. He knows that Neo can see these subtle changes. The Merovingian is trying to teach him something.
She does not understand why. Is it the wine? No. What is it then? What is the reason? And soon it does not matter. Soon the why and the reason are gone. And all that matters is the feeling itself. And this is the nature of the universe. We struggle against it. We fight to deny it. But it is, of course, pretends it is a lie. Beneath our poised appearance, truth is, we are completely out of control.
This is the scene that made us suspect that the Oracle changed Neo with the cookie. The Merovingian is explaining two things. One is that the woman began to feel changes in her body after eating the dessert, changes that she could not control. At first, she thought it was the wine, but it didn't matter what caused the strange reaction. Her impulses were telling her to get up. And two, the woman could not understand the why. She follows her impulses, just like Neo, Morpheus, and Trinity. None of them understand the why. Here, the Merovingian modified the cake to change the woman's behavior. The Oracle could have very well done the same to Neo. He feels an impulse to do what she tells him to. That impulse derives from the love that was encoded into him and his predecessors by the Architect. In other words, the Merovingian is saying that Neo was at the Frenchman's restaurant because others manipulated him to go there. What is disturbing about this is that he set up a demonstration by showing Neo the modified dessert, as implying that the same was done to Neo. The Merovingian is also telling Neo that he can pretend all he wants, but he cannot deny his purpose, just like Smith told him in the park.
We're here because we are not free. There is no escaping reason, no denying purpose, because as we both know, without purpose, we would not exist.
Both Smith and the Merovingian seem to have a common understanding of what's going on, but Neo is completely oblivious.
Causality. There is no escape from it. We are forever slaves to it. Our only hope, our only peace is to understand it, to understand the why. Why is what separates us from them. You from me. Why is the only real source of power? Without it, you are powerless. And this is how you come to me. That why was our power. Another link in the chain.
Up until this moment, everyone had told Neo that he was the one, a deity to be worshipped by the inhabitants of Zion and feared by the agents of the Matrix. Yet here is a program that's telling him that he has no power, that he doesn't know why he is here. The Merovingian might seem self-centered during this entire scene, criticizing the Matrix cycle, though we dare say that the Frenchman is trying to make Neo understand the truth of his situation, that Neo has no power. He is a tool being used by the Architect and the Oracle. Neo should be surprised and enlightened by this conversation, but he doesn't take the Merovingian's conversation to heart. To him, the Frenchman is just an egomaniacal program.
But fear not, since I have seen how good you are at following orders, I will tell you what to do next. Run back and give the fortune teller this message. A time. Now, I have some real business to do, so I will say adieu and goodbye.
The Frenchman lets the trio know that they are not the heroes of the story. They are pawns following the orders of the Oracle, and he ends this civil conversation with a threat to the Oracle. The Merovingian is anti-system and harbors a deep hatred towards the Oracle. He belittles the so-called Path of the One by saying that he has more important business to take care of. For an ancient and powerful program that has survived multiple Matrix cycles, the Merovingian only sees Neo as a pawn, and as a warning that the Matrix will soon be restarted yet again. The war, the path of the One, it's all unimportant and pointless to the Merovingian. What matters to him is his war against the Oracle.
This isn't over. Oh yes, it is. The Keymaker is mine, and I see no reason why I should give him up.
The Merovingian having the Keymaker imprisoned serves two purposes. The first is to have the program that grants him access to travel anywhere in the Matrix instantaneously. And second, to disrupt or delay the end of the Matrix cycle and take his revenge on the Oracle and the Architect. Though his contempt is more focused on the Oracle than the Architect. We already made a video explaining why.
Where are you going?
Please, my chérie, I've told you. We are all victims of causality. I drink too much wine. I must take a piece.
So what do you think? Could the Merovingian be one of the few characters that spoke the truth to Neo? Next time, the Merovingian discovers that he does not have control over everything, and he learns that fact the hard way.
Listen to me. This meeting is completely unofficial.
You cannot even mention my ministry.
Trust me.
Your
Oslo Channel began with the hopes of creating a dialogue between the Palestinians and Israel. If this fails, lives will be ruined.
Why would I accept your help? A discussion held somewhere isolated, where you and the PLO can meet.
I have never met an Israeli face to face.
No secret Norwegian channel between Israel and the PLO.
You're a junior minister. Today is just a sociologist.
You are my first Jew. In my country, we see you as terrorists and murderers.
In my country, we see you as a savage nation whose army shoots our children for sport.
I can do business with this man.
The progress that was made in one two-day meeting is beyond imagination.
The ways are strange, but through the methods, we have begun a true dialogue between our peoples.
Our countries live in the past, both obsessing over what we have lost. Let us find a way to live in the present.
Oh, God, I love you. If you take one more step, I swear I will divorce you.
It is illegal for an Israeli official to speak to the PLO.
If you continue down this path and the world finds out what you are all doing, there will be riots. Blood will be spilled.
Your fighting is killing your own children.
Our fighting has forced you to fear us.
You will accept this document or we've all agreed to what we have done.
We are all victims of causality. That was not smooth. Let's try again. We are all victims of causality.